Ephesians chapter number 5, if you will, Ephesians chapter number 5. We have two chapters left in the book of Ephesians, and it's been a wonderful study about the grace of God towards us as members of the body of Christ. I always want to remind you that the book of Ephesians, its focus is God's devotion in His grace to us, particularly us Gentiles, okay? Those cast off far, far away from Almighty God in time past. Again, the book of Colossians, its spousal epistle. Ephesians is like, it represents the wife or the body of Christ, Ephesians 5, where Colossians represents Christ as the head of that body. And it's the husband, okay, and the head. And what Colossians focus on is our devotion to our Lord. I always remind you that Ephesians speaks about the every name that is named, but not the thrones, because that's not what it's about. It's just about God's love, and even to the lowliest of the low, even those who are unfaithful, God will be faithful. God is faithful, Brother James would always say. But Colossians, the sister epistle is what you usually call, what I call it, the spousal epistle, the one that is the head, like Christ, it focuses on our devotion to Him. It's the conditional verses about the reward of the inheritance for you serve the Lord Christ as a joint heir. So it is these two books that we compare and contrast, but they do have different things. In Colossians, Paul mentions the throne. He doesn't in Ephesians. But by the way, in Colossians, he doesn't mention the every name that is named, the lowly of the saint, because that's not the issue, just getting there. It's pressing toward that mark of the prize of the high calling God in Christ Jesus, the book of Philippians, in between them, okay? So when we look at chapter 5, what we're going to see is that we're to walk in love, because that's how God walks and that's how the Lord Jesus Christ walks. What we're going to see is in these last days of grace, there is a lack of love. I tell you guys all the time, I've been inundated of people by some recent events where they say there's some brothers who have lack of love towards others in as far as in their disagreements with things. You can disagree with someone, but you can do it lovingly. It doesn't have to be just this hate-filled rants and so forth, as some do. It's not the way that Christ would have handled things. It's not the way the Apostle Paul handled things. And we're to be as God, followers of God. Look at verse 1. Be ye therefore followers of God as dear children, children who are dear to Him. That word dear, He can't live without you. Be ye therefore followers of God. What is the therefore? Go back, if you will, verse 31 of chapter number 4. When Paul writes this, you don't have these section breaks. It's just continuing on. So let's get the context. Pardon. Let all bitterness, and wrath, and anger, and clamor, and evil speaking be put away from you with all malice. Unfortunately, those are some of the last days of grace type of dealings with brethren, and it's sad. And Paul said, let all that stuff be put away from you. Let all bitterness and wrath and anger and clamor. We went through all those a couple weeks ago before our trip out. He says, an evil speaking be put away from you with all malice. Over in 1 Corinthians 14, Paul says, in malice be children. Don't be malicious. Children aren't malicious one to another, little children. We watch Jada-Lynn with other 5- and 4-year-olds. They're not malicious. But in understanding, be men, he says, 1 Corinthians 14. Verse number 32. And be ye kind one to another. Again, that was our last study a couple weeks ago. Tenderhearted, forgiving one another, even as God for Christ's sake hath forgiven you. If there's a quarrel, he says in Colossians 3:13, there's a quarrel, forgive one another, even as God for Christ's sake forgive you. That's how God operates, and that's how we should. Verse chapter 5, verse 1. Be ye therefore. You see how God deals with you? Be ye therefore followers of God. What a child does is follow their daddy. Unless it's a little girl, she follows her mommy. I watch Jada-Lynn, Krista, wherever Krista go, Jada-Lynn soon follows, right? Because she looks up to her mommy. She wants to be like her and all that. Now she wants to be Wonder Woman, sorry. Let me change that.
Well, Mom is Wonder Woman.
She wanted to be Elsa from Frozen for like a month. Now all of a sudden it's Wonder Woman, okay? She's going around with a lasso trying to, any bad guys in the house, just lasso you with a lasso of truth. Besides that, she likes to be like her mom. She follows her around. I have to tell Krista, I say, be careful because, yeah, you might trip over. She just kind of follows right behind her. Well, that is natural affection of our daughter with her mother. Well, that's how we ought to be with God the Father in the things that God does, which is his kindness and so forth. Look at verse 1. Be ye therefore followers of God as dear children and what? Walk in love. Tonight's study is called Walking in Love. And what we're going to see is that what it's all about, this life in the Lord Jesus Christ, is how you treat your brethren. I'm reminded, I'm going to talk about James a lot, our dearly departed brother who died 2 weeks ago and we were to do his funeral. Because his words of wisdom, his pearls of wisdom, he says, Brother Ron, the last thing he said to me in person last July, you never have to worry about how I treat another brother or sister or another member because I feared that. And he pointed to the judgment seat of Christ, my title on the board that day in July. And he walked in love because he understood the issue with the avenger of all such, 1 Thessalonians chapter 4. Because the greatest way you can show your love for the Lord Jesus is to show love for his word, faith, and then show love for other saints. Faith and love equals righteousness. Paul talks about the breastplate of faith and love, but he also talks about the breastplate of righteousness. Ephesians, he calls it the breastplate of righteousness. Ephesians 6, we'll see that. But in 1 Thessalonians, he calls it, chapter 5, the breastplate of faith and love. So what faith and love equals is righteousness. What righteousness equals is faith in the Lord Jesus and love to all saints. That's how you know you're pleasing God. If you can look at yourself and say, a crown of righteousness is what we're looking to get. That's what he promises. 2 Timothy 4, okay? And righteousness equals, it's a couple of things. Faith in the Lord Jesus. You hear Paul talks about faith and love a lot. Or the work of faith, labor, and love. Also, it equals glory. All have sinned and come short of the glory of God, his perfect righteousness. So righteousness is faith and love. It equals glory at the judgment seat, that crown of righteousness, to reign with him. Somebody asked me, Ron, can you succinctly talk about what a joint-heir means? I said, when you suffer with him, not just any general suffering, with him in the mystery, what that equals is the crown. You're only going to crown if you strive lawfully. You got to be in the right message, the mystery. And it's a crown of righteousness. Who love his appearing, and his appearing, Paul mentions in 2 Timothy chapter 1. He says, who is now, through his appearing, the gospel given to Paul, the mystery. And he talks about suffering with him. It's when you suffer, you'll be joint heir with Christ. If so be, conditionally, if you suffer with him, that you might be glorified together. And what that means is to reign. So in essence, reign with him. Being a joint heir with Christ, equal share, has to do with reigning with him. Okay? That's simply what it means.
Because that's what he's left to inherit.
That's what reigning. He's left to inherit. By the way, people think this, watch you say that. People don't understand there's a future coronation coming for the Lord Jesus Christ in the heavenly places. It is not done yet. It happens at his presentation with the body of Christ to the Father. First, we have to have the judgment seat of Christ. So there's some events that take place. Then him coronated, who in his times, people don't know, who in his times, first, that's 1 Timothy, in his times, future, he shall show who is the blessed and only potentate, the King of kings, the Lord of lords. That's a future event, 1 Timothy. But see, you have to study out all of Paul's epistles and believe it to see all this. And what being a joint heir means to reign with him, because there's a future coronation, the glory that shall be revealed. He shall be glorified together. Don't get mad at other people studying this out. This is in Paul's epistles. It makes sense. So being a joint heir is to reign with him. It is a future coronation for the heavenly places, those thrones, dominions, principalities, and powers that God desires the body of Christ to serve in. But not everyone will reign and serve in those positions of authority. Everyone will be in the kingdom, but not everybody will serve. It's only those who walk the way that he says to walk, in righteousness, crown of righteousness, which is faith and love, and you will receive the glory to reign with him. Let's look at this. Verse 2. And walk in love. What kind of walk should we have? A walk of love. Now watch this. We walk by what? Faith. Everybody knows that. 2 Corinthians 5:7. For we walk by faith. But there's another way we walk, or ought to walk. What? Faith, which works by love. We need to walk in love. And your sanctification is that right there. As you do the work of faith and you build up the doctrine of the Apostle Paul, the mystery, you're to let that thing work in you by faith. And when you do, you're going to be bringing forth the fruits of righteousness, by the way, which are by Jesus Christ to the praise and glory of God. It's not you doing it in your flesh. It is you taking the word of God, believing the mystery of Christ, all Paul's epistles, because I'm running into that lately, that people do, oh, it's just this, and we don't. Read all of Paul's epistles. Stop playing with the word. Study the word, all of what Paul says. And when you do that, you're going to see that it is faith and love, and there's glory associated with that. And that's what God wrought in Paul's epistles. Paul says, henceforth there is laid up, I know whom I have believed, 2 Timothy 1. And I am persuaded that he is able to keep that. There's a song.
Right.
Every Grace Church sings this song. I know my God's one. There's a song. Because I know whom I have believed in and am persuaded that he is able to keep that which I have committed unto him against
that day,
the judgment seat of Christ. What do you think Paul is saying there? It's just frustrating because this is the battle amongst dispensationalism. It's like people, they don't study Paul. They're Pauline, but they don't study Paul. To walk in love, notice, verse 2, walk in love, there's a walk of love. That's a sanctified walk. As Christ also hath what?
Loved
us. The Lord Jesus Christ has proven his love for us. You know, I think about what Paul says. I end every session. You have to give the gospel. I never assume the people watching, although most of them are saved and are grace believers. If you're watching me over the course of time, it's going to be hard for you to do that and not be saved and a grace believer. But if you think about it, I end every session by saying, I love you. These saints love you. That's why we do this ministry. But more importantly, who loves you? God does. And he commended, he proved and demonstrated his love in a tangible way in human history. And that while we are yet sinners, Christ died for us. Romans 5, verse 8, one of my favorite verses of the gospel. And what the Lord did, he gave himself. Look at verse number 2 again. As Christ also have loved us. What type of love was that? It was a
sacrificial.
Dorothy, I couldn't even get it out of my mouth. You said it, sacrificial love. Good, I'm going to write that.
Absolutely.
No wonder people love you. You know?
What a sacrifice.
Yeah. We got a woman coming over from Saudi Arabia. She's going to be here probably this month or next, but she's in the States. She wants to come. Krista's going to get in contact with her. And she's coming all the way from Saudi Arabia to visit family, but to come here to California to meet us. And she knows her name, Nola, that's my grandmother, my mother's side name.
Nola.
Sacrifice. And we say it probably every session. Life as a grace believer is a life of sacrifice. When Brother James served in the Vietnam War, he received a military honors burial at Fort Snelling in Minnesota. So what took the funeral so long because they had to fit him in there. They gave him 21 gun salute, boom, boom, boom. They gave him the taps. They had the young guy from the Marines just sitting there, you know, doing his thing. And they got all these. It was a big fanfare. And they said, they looked at his widow right there, Jane. There's a casket right there. I was there. Joshua, we were right there. And he said, on behalf of the commander, you know, the United States Army, the President of the United States, we thank you for your service, your husband's service and sacrifice. That's what they said, didn't they, there? That was just last Wednesday. And because of that sacrifice, James was honored. Get that. A life of sacrifice, it gives honor and glory to God, and it's one that he recompenses. Everybody understands that.
It's joyful, too.
I know, exactly. It's joyful.
There's joy in it.
Well, that comes with joy and faith and belief, peace and believing. look at our world. With our military, everybody clap when they're coming off the plane. And they see people at the ball game. Oh, he's in the military. Everybody clap. What are, they're honoring the sacrifice of these men and women, putting their lives on the line. You're putting your life on the line.
You think the angels will rejoice over our sacrifice?
They currently are. The holy angels are.
In that day?
Yes. The holy angels are right now. We're upsetting the evil principalities and powers.
Yeah.
But in that coronation day, which the angels of God will be a part of, that's part of their job in heavenly places, mm-hmm. there will be a rejoicing for them. Because all, see, remember, Dorothy, the angels watches because they knew one day God, their father, their sons of God, heavenly sons of God, they knew one day he would make things right. They didn't know how and neither when. Two things they didn't know was how he would clean the heavens up, body of Christ, mystery, nor when. They didn't see that coming. Satan didn't see that coming. Paul, when Paul was saved, nobody saw that coming.
It was a secret.
It was a secret, a mystery.
Right.
Now they know, and now, you know what? Romans 8, the earnest expectation of the creature waited for the manifestation of the sons of God. Dorothy, what is heaven doing right now? They're waiting for God to send the Lord Jesus Christ back for the body so we can get on with the program, cleaning up these heavens. Michael and his angels are ready, and they're ready to war with Satan. Well, first of all, they're ready to escort the Lord. Let me say that first. They're ready to escort the Lord down to the air here, to our first heaven. But then after that, they're going to be preparing to, during the judgment seat of Christ, which will probably take 10 years, I think. Anyway, they're going to prepare to do this war out in the future with Satan and his angels, kick them out the heavenly places, right? And that's when the body of Christ will be put out there. All right. My point is, we understand in our regular life that sacrifice, even the ultimate sacrifice by some soldiers, it leads to honor and glory. They get medals and stuff, honor, the Bible way with the U, glory. They get medals, the Congressional Medal of Honor, or the Purple Heart, or whatever. All that stuff is for sacrifice. By the way, does everybody in America, can I just walk down the street and the president say, hey, you're a good guy. Here's an honor. Here's a Purple Heart or something. No, they only give it to people who sacrifice in war, in warfare. The average citizen doesn't get these medals because he hasn't put his life on the line.
Sadly, those medals are usually like pentagrams and stuff.
Well, yeah, well, that's a whole other thing. I was going to mention that they've draped his casket with an American flag and then folded it up and gave it to her. But you understand, that's the way it's what it represents.
They did that for my dad, too.
We know the deeper, yeah, exactly.
Yeah, the flag.
We know the deeper things in that. But you understand, it's what all that stuff represents, a life of sacrifice. If James hadn't served in the military in war and so forth, he would have not gotten those things. It's the same way we're in a spiritual warfare, and only those who are going to battle for the truth of the mystery are going to be rewarded. Well, he says, walk in love, as Christ also hath loved us, and hath given himself for us, what? An offering and a sacrifice to God for a sweet-smelling savor. Let me talk to you about this. He gave himself for us. The Lord Jesus Christ knew from the start, as he grew in the Word. We always want to talk about, when you read the Gospels, the Word of God, that's what he was known as before he became Jesus. He became what? Flesh. John 1:14, and that's Jesus. That is his, Jehovah is salvation, save his people. And then the flesh, that perfect flesh became the Word again, okay? Through his 33 years and so forth, probably really 30 years, and for 3.5 years he just put that all on display as a son. You know what I'm saying? Here's the point. There's this thing, but Jesus learned, young Jesus learned from about age 12.
Obedience.
Huh?
Obedience.
Yes, but age 12 to 30, you know what he learned that in that obedience, Dorothy? That God gave him a body in order to die. Let's look at that. I just want you to see what he means. Now, it's going to look different for us. The principle's the same, but he can only he could do what he did. Okay? Let's look at this. Go with me, if you will, to Hebrews chapter 10. Go over to Hebrews chapter 10. I just want you to see that when Jesus of Nazareth read the scriptures, was taught the scriptures as a young man, he understood that he was born to die.
I've had people say that he didn't know that.
Those people do err not knowing the scripture.
Yeah, they didn't know that he was from the beginning either.
Yeah. Habakkuk,
his creator.
Habakkuk chapter 5 verse 2 says, "Oh Israel, your judge, your prince, your ruler is from everlasting. Okay? Unto us, Isaiah, unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given. Well, we're going to see Psalms in a minute. Okay, so this Hebrews, but it's quoting a psalm that Jesus would read. I mean, Jesus could read Isaiah 53 and say, yep, make his soul an offering for sin. He made his grave with the wicked. I mean, couldn't he read Daniel chapter 9, Messiah shall be cut off? Jesus read and knew those verses. Mm-hmm. He knew who those verses were about me. He said, hey, you search the scriptures looking for eternal life. They are those which testify of me, he says in John. Here's some of them right here. Look at Hebrews chapter 10, verse 5. Talking about those sacrifices under the law. Verse number 4. For it is not possible that the blood of bulls and goats should take away sins. What did Moses do under that law, or the law of Moses teach Israel for 1,500 years? The blood, bulls and goats and all the sacrifice, the lambs and all these things. Verse number 4. But when you're looking at it, it is not possible that the blood of bulls and goats should take away sins. How in the world can God allow an innocent animal, all the way from the beginning, by the way, with Adam, God clothed him, to really deal with the sins of mankind? Well, because it was a picture of the true Lamb of God, the true sacrifice. That's right, the pure. Verse number 5. Wherefore, when he cometh into the world, speaking of Messiah, he said, by the way, when he come into the world, Jesus knew these facts right there. He was just as a little boy. He learned deeper truths about it over the course of the next 18 years. But he knew this. When he was in that temple in the book of Luke, showing his humanity, asking questions and answering, he was asking about he was asking about Messiah. He was preparing Israel for his return in 18 years. Here, watch this. Sacrifice, verse 5. Sacrifice and offering thou wouldest not, but a what? Body hast thou prepared me. But wait a minute, didn't God desire sacrifice and offering? Yes. But really, what this is saying is that wasn't the actual thing he desired. It was a picture and type and shadow of what foreshadowing the Messiah. Verse number 6. In burnt offerings and sacrifices for sin thou hast no pleasure. Then said I, lo, as Messiah's reading this, he says, I get it. Lo, I come in the volume of the book it is written of me to do thy will, O God. Yeah. Above, when he said, sacrifice and offering, burnt offerings and offering for sin, thou wouldest not. Neither hast thou pleasure therein, which are offered by the what? Law. That was all temporary. This was the real deal right here. Oh, watch this, verse 9. Then said he, lo, I come to do thy will, O God. He taketh away the first. What is that? That's that Old Testament law. Right, all the things associated with the Mosaic law.
Right.
That he may what? Establish
the second.
That's going to be the new covenant. Jeremiah 31, Ezekiel 36, what Jesus came to shed his blood to do for Israel. Now, one more verse. By the which will we, that's Israel, the Hebrews in the context, are sanctified through the offering of the what of the Lord?
Body
of Jesus Christ once for all. And what that sacrifice on Calvary meant for Israel is that now God can begin a program where he won't deal with them under that bondage of the law of Moses, yet they still would do his will, but he's going to give them the Spirit. He's going to write his word in their hearts and so forth. That's all, like Ryan said, the Day of Atonement. Once that all taken care of, here we go with Israel. But I just wanted you to see that was what Israel looked for. Go back to Psalm 40. Jesus would have read this in Psalm chapter 40. The Lord Jesus, as a young man, or throughout his life, would have read this, among many others I just quoted, in Psalm chapter 40.
As he grew in wisdom and stature. Right?
He grew in wisdom and stature. You know, I was talking to Matt. We were saying that with the resurgent truths of the Apostle Paul in these last days of grace, what you're going to do is, we believe there's no higher pinnacle doctrine this issue of the joint heirship. What we're going to do now with the time is just basically dig deeper and grow in that understanding over time. That's it. Because it's the plateau. We're going to set up base camp on the top of Mount Air and just dig on in there, see what we can find. It's just growing. And that's what Jesus did. He grew in wisdom and stature and so forth. He grew in his understanding of who he is and what he came to do for Israel. But little did he know, he didn't. Not at the time he was on this earth. Neither does the Son, not Mark 13. Is that God the Father, oh, the wisdom of God. No wonder Paul would say, oh, the depths of the wisdom. Can I tell you, that's what was on Paul's mind when he said, oh, the depths of the wisdom, both of the wisdom and knowledge of God, Romans 11. All this stuff God had, which was fantastic in prophecy, God the Father had another secret purpose already in the wings, already had it, that he was going to do through this death at Calvary. That's fantastic. That's what we do, the mystery. The angels knew God would reconcile the heavens. They just didn't know when and how. And now we know through the mystery given to the Apostle Paul. Now look at Psalm 40, verse number 6. Psalm 40, verse 6. Psalm 40, verse 6. It's so funny when people, we get a lot of calls, people follow us on YouTube and Jan's blog and so forth. And they're just so excited. I was telling Krista, this guy from San Jose, he was just so excited. They will just talk for like 10 minutes straight. I don't have to say nothing. I just go, praise the Lord. Amen. Because they're like, oh, we're around. We thank y'all. There ain't that many people. They telling me, they go, there ain't that many people out here to Jesus. Amen. I try to tell them to share people. They don't want to. I go, tell me something I don't know. I just let them vent. Maybe, I was like, amen. Praise the Lord. Thank God. Because, yeah, that's what people come to know. A lot of people aren't teaching these things. Psalm 40, look at verse number
6.
Let's just go right in 6. Sacrifice and offering thou didst not desire. Mine ears hath thou opened. By the way, let me just make a comment on that. In Isaiah, it talks about, you know, he has open ears to hear the word. But there's some allusion back to Exodus chapter 21, verse 6, that if a Hebrew servant was in the house of his master, and when he was now free to go, he's supposed to go out free for nothing after the 7 years, right? If he got a wife and children in that time, the wife and children were the master's, but he could go. But let's say he says, it's all a type of Christ and the Father's house in Israel as the bride and the children. The servant says, you know what? I love my master. I love my wife and children. I want to remain under his roof forever. You would go down to the judges of Israel, and you take a spike and put it. That's where earrings come from, by the way. Submission, servanthood. And you put that in there, and you bore his ear a hole with an awl in his ear. And he would be his master forever. That's what that is. It's not just he's hearing the word. That's that I come to do thy will. I'm going to stay in your house, Father. And with Israel and the children of Abraham, we're going to serve you. It's opening his ears. Exodus 21. Mine ears hast thou opened. Burnt offering and sacrifice hast thou not required. But wait a minute, he did. But really, he didn't. All pointing to the true sacrifice of the Lord Jesus. Verse number 7. Then said I, lo, I come in the volume of the book it is written of me.
That's the second time we just heard that.
Well, because Hebrews is quoting Psalm.
Right, yeah. Right.
That's why when somebody says Jesus didn't know except the fact about the mystery. If you say he didn't know the mystery, I'm talking about Jesus of Nazareth during his earthly ministry, didn't know the mystery. But if there was anything else of God's word that, he didn't know the, let me start. He didn't know the day and the hour, Mark 13, okay? But my point is, if there's anything about himself that anybody claims he didn't know, they do err not knowing the scripture. Because of this, Isaiah 61, Isaiah 53, Daniel 9, Messiah's cut off, he knew he was going to die.
Daniel 7,
we can go, yeah, the Son of Man goes, Fact is, Jesus of Nazareth knew all of God's word in prophecy, except the time
that
he would return.
Word.
Anybody who said, and Dorothy, that's my life every day. People just say stuff. Yeah. Who is this that darkeneth counsel with words without knowledge? They said in Job.
Right.
That's the life of a grace believer. Because people say stuff or write stuff and they don't know what they're talking about. And that's my frustration. But hey, Christ dealt with that a lot more. Paul dealt with that a lot more than any of us. Verse number 6. So here's the quote from Hebrews. Sacrifice and offering thou didst not desire. Mine ears has thou opened. A guy sent me this thing. He says, Brother Ron, everyone's a joint-heir. Look at this video. I go, no. I go, in my years of studying this out, I know what it is. You tell me what your years of studying of this out is all about. Don't give me what somebody else said. You let's have a conversation. Call me. Guy didn't call me. Because I know the guy is just going off of his emotions and what some other dude said in a video, but he hasn't studied it out. See, I don't let people off the hook. I say, no. I studied this out. I don't need this guy. You study it out, or you call me and let me ask you questions. Let's go to verses. It's always crickets then. See, I don't let people off with that. Yeah, look at this. No, you look at this. Let's look at the word together. We'll do that. You have to study things out and not just jump because somebody says something. Not whether it even's me. Because I'm going to give you the verses. And I deal with people on verses. And I'm not a phone person, but on those things, call me. I give my number, say, call me right away. If it's crickets, because they don't want to deal with me, but call me. That's just, we got to stop all that nonsense. Let's deal with the verses, not just what somebody said. Then said, I come in the volume of the book. It is written of me, verse 8, I what? Delight to do thy will, O my God. That's how you use O my God in a proper sense. O my God.
That's prophetic.
Yea, thy what? Thy law is within my what?
Heart.
Did you know that the Lord Jesus Christ was the true Israel? He had something that no other Israelite had. Because of his purity, because of being the Son of God, he had already what Israel will get in the future. He had that law written in his heart. He was the living Word of Almighty God. He was a picture of what every Israeli will be in that kingdom. Every time I read the Gospels, it's amazing because I see what life in the kingdom would be. When you look at Jesus, you say, that's how every Jew would be. Well, you know, I'm talking about the glorified ones. There's going to be a group of Jews, Isaiah 65. They're going to be the offspring of those overcomers who didn't die, and they're going to still have flesh in their flesh. But anyway, set in their members. But you understand what I mean. The glorified ones. Well, the Lord Jesus, he was a beautiful picture of what life in of a Jew would be in that kingdom. If you've seen me, Philip, you've seen the Father. What does the Son of God in Israel's program look like? Look at Jesus. What does the Son of God in this program look like? Look at the Apostle Paul. Go back, if you will, to Philippians chapter 2. Now, I went through all that in the prophetic program because Paul, our apostle, uses this information from prophecy to show us the mindset. You know, I think about the judgment seat of Christ is the judgment seat of Christ. And he's looking for the mind of Christ. It's the judgment seat of Christ. We talk about the mind of Christ. I got an email, she goes, that study on the mind of Christ, whoa, people don't get that. She's like, that was excellent. I go, you're right, people don't get that. You've only learned that from studying out Paul. It's of Christ. Remember what Christ is. Thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God. That has to do with being a son, operating a son. And what the judgment seat of Christ is, he's looking for those who had operated as sons down here on earth, who have redeemed the time as walking as sons and daughters. It's the mind of Christ, the mind of Christ. 2 Corinthians 10, it's the obedience of Christ. And what we're about to see in this one is the obedience, the mind, and what we're going to see is the reward for walking as a son, for Jesus especially. But we can have the same thing in our dispensation of grace. Let's look at Philippians chapter 2, verse 5. Dorothy, I know this is one of your favorites.
My favorite.
But when Paul, in fact, let me start at verse 1. If there be therefore any consolation in Christ, and there is, if any comfort of love, there is, if any fellowship of the Spirit, there is, if any bowels and mercies, these inward yearnings of the Lord Jesus Christ, there is in the doctrine. Fulfill ye my joy that ye be what? Like-minded. What does that mean? Having the same love. Being of one accord, of one mind. And that's that walking in love together in the doctrine. Let nothing be done through strife or vainglory. Strife. Striving, contention, vainglory, seeking glory that has nothing to do with what God's doing. I'm telling you, there are people that they're in pulpits now simply because it's just a job, and they get famous, and they let it go to their head and their pride, vainglory, stuff that won't go to the glory of the Lord or them at the judgment seat of Christ. They're just playing around with this stuff. It's a hard issue. Fulfill ye my joy. So verse number 3, let nothing be done through strife or vainglory, but in what? Lowliness of mind. You know what lowliness of mind is? Let each esteem other better than themselves. I told you how a brother in the Lord called me. Humble man. He wants some answers about some recent events. And he said, a preacher told him, dispensational teacher told him, you're not in a pulpit. You can't talk to me about those things.
What?
Yeah. Yeah. They see others as peons and things in their mind. As no authority lesser. See, this stuff is real. If you're seeing people as better yourself, guess what? You won't be having that attitude about other members of the body of Christ. This stuff is real. You can't be saying and doing, acting that way and seeing other members of the body of Christ better than yourself with lowliness of mind. Humility. Verse number 4. Look not every man on his own things. Don't just be concerned about yourself. But every man also on the things of others. Look to edify and to help others. Bear their burdens. I'm thankful for the people who call and say, Brother Ron, we heard this. Please tell us what's going on. Thank you for calling. And I tell them. You don't shush somebody away. What was you saying, Dorothy?
This is where I am with Charlene.
Yes.
She can't understand the sacrifices that I make for her. And I said, Charlene, it brings me joy.
Amen. Well, because you have the mind of Christ.
Right. That's why it means so much to me, that scripture.
It happens to all of us. As you give of yourself to others, one of the things people say, oh, Brother Ryan, I know you're so busy, man. Thank you for taking the time. And I tell them, they say, so I don't want to waste your time. And I go, my time is for you. It's number one for my wife, for Jada-Lynn, for my mother and father, and then for these saints here, and then for you. There's priorities, but it's not a bother to me. It's a pleasure for me. When somebody asks me to help them with a Bible question, that's a pleasure. It's not a nuisance.
You get excited.
I get excited. Laurel, I'm still grieved that Laurel's not with us.
I know.
Oh, she was just throwing them left and right, you know. But her pride, she has to deal with that pride.
Yeah.
Deal with that pride. Speaking of, verse number 5, let this mind, this grace thinking of the mind of Christ, how does a son operate? Well, let this mind be in you, which was also in who? The Son of Christ Jesus. Now, Paul's going to go and say, let's look at how this man walked under his dispensation of the law. Here we go. What was his mindset? Who, being in the form of God, thought it not robbery to be equal with God. Do you understand what Paul is saying there? Jesus Christ knew he was God. Jesus. But his mindset was, it's not robbery for man if it's done the way God intended, like with Adam, like what Jesus is showing, to be equal with God, to share jointly in his glory. Now, that's going to make some people say, what? Because it's not taught. What do you... You tell me. Call me. Tell me what that verse means. You tell me what it means. who being in the form of God, he's talking about Jesus, God the Son, who walked and walked around in Israel, understanding the plan and purpose for God with Israel to share in his glory. He says in Revelation, to him that overcometh, I will give him to sit in my throne as I sit in my Father's throne. That's what being a joint heir is. Joint heir is, think about what Romans 5 verse 2. Let's read verse 1. Therefore, being justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, by whom also we have what? Access by faith, there's the walk of faith, into this grace wherein we stand and rejoice in what? Hope. In hope of the glory of God. God has something. First Corinthians 2, he said, which God ordained before the world unto what? Our glory. Who seek for glory, immortality, eternal life. Those who seek patient, continuing, well-doing, seek. God has wrought that in the heart, if you listen to Paul, because God just doesn't want you to go get in and sweep up the, you know, the hay of the horses in heaven to hold up the door. He wants you to listen. He created a whole creature in heavenly places that his Son has now, he has the rule and reign of. It's going to be actualized in the future. And he's looking for some people who operated just like Jesus did in our dispensation, by faith, in the Father's will, so that although Jesus will sit down here on this throne, there's thrones, Colossians 1:16. God wants sons. He might be the firstborn among many brothers. This is real. There's a heavenly kingdom out there that God wants to put the body of Christ in charge of. And he's asking us, beseeching us through Paul, be a part of what I'm doing. I press toward the mark, that's Philippians 3, of the prize of the high calling of God in Christ. This has to be preached. Watch. Verse 6, who being in the form of God. Only God can make this determination, you know? Let us make man in our image and in our likeness. What in the world does that mean in Genesis 1:26? We're going to make a creature. It's not a created being, but a creature who's just like us, the Godhead. He's going to be a spitting image of all we are. He's going to bear my glory, our glory in the earth. What do you think Jesus is doing? He has that same purpose for the heavenly places through the body of Christ. The body of Christ. Of Christ. All right, let's keep looking. Thought it not robbery to be equal with God. By the way, there's only two times that word equal with God is used. We went over this. In the book of John, equal with God. And if you're a student of God's word, let me tell you, if something is mentioned twice, exactly twice, that's a witness. And what God wants you to look, say, oh, over there in John,
5:18.
Thank you, Mother. 5:17-18. He says, he called himself the Son of God, making himself what? Equal with God, in connection to being a son. That's what it means. It's walking as a son. Thought it not robbery to be equal with God, but watch what Jesus did. Made himself of what?
No reputation.
And took upon him the form of a what?
Servant.
Oh, you want to know what humility is? In John, I think it's John 15, if I'm not mistaken, when Jesus gets down on his hands and knees, grabs a washcloth, so it's a basin, and he starts to wash that Middle East dust right off his apostles' feet. That was God doing that. That was the Son of God. And his humility, Peter says, God forbid you do that, Lord. He says, but you want to be clean, man, don't you? I got to clean you. I got to clean you for ministry, Peter. He's like, clean my entire body then, Lord. He goes, no, your feet are sufficient because you're going to walk in my shoes, bro. Listen, humility. And I always remember that if the Lord Jesus Christ can get on his hands and knees and wash somebody's, some bunch of dudes' stinky, smelly, dusty, sandy feet, who are we not to do anything? Krista and I, both at our assembly back home, I did it even before I met her, and now we still take out the Okay, we in every setting, take out the garbage. Doesn't matter, because this is our life, our ministry is our family. We're going to do whatever we have to do. We're going to serve the saints in any capacity we can. And the Lord got down there and did that. And that, what he was showing them how to be a servant. He that is greatest among you shall be servant of all. It's not about one. We get accused, oh, we want to reign over some people. What are you talking about?
Don't be servant.
You want to just be in charge of some people. That's not the motivation. I want to do what the Father's will is in the verses. Craziness. I don't care about what. Yeah. If that was the case, I'd be telling Dorothy, get the garbage when you leave out. Take the garbage with you. I'm the pastor, but y'all ain't been doing it.
Yes, sir.
No. I said, Dorothy, you have any garbage for me to take out for you, you know? That's craziness. The accusation of people, because you know all of Paul's epistles, all his doctrine, and you teach it. No, a servant. And he's made in the likeness of men, except without sin. And being found in fashion as a man, found. When you searched him out, found him. Here Paul says to us, we have to be found faithful at the rapture or our death, like Brother James. Okay, being found in fashion as a man, he did what? Humbled himself. See, you have to make the choice of your will to walk in humility, lowliness of mind, and so forth. He became, and you mentioned it, Dorothy, obedient, right? The obedience of Christ. Obedient unto what? Death.
Right.
But, as Krista was talking to me one day, it says even, and that means that is, in particular, that is the death of the cross. What does he mean, the death of the cross? Well, because that cross was a particular type of death. It was one of a sin offering, a sacrifice, and that's what we're looking at in Ephesians. It was a sacrifice.
Humiliation.
Yeah, well, it was a lot of things, but ultimately, he took that, he made his soul an offering for, it was a sin offering, Isaiah 53. Now, he's the only one who could do that, okay? None of us were born into this world sinless like Jesus was. Jesus was the only human being since Adam and Eve who had pure. It is. We were talking about whether Adam and Eve had blood. Chance. Our thoughts was no. That's something that came in after the fall. They were flesh and bone. Bone in my bone, flesh in my flesh, like Jesus is, but in his resurrection body.
But we can sense sacrifice for in small things.
Ah, you see, you're coming right with me, Dorothy. As we progress in this study, we're going to see that we can live a sacrifice. We're not going to physically, well, I guess you could, but that death of the cross was a sacrificial death, the second death, as it were, right? Well, he experienced, although he was on the cross for 6 hours, for three of those hours, he experienced his soul an offering for sin, became a worm, he experienced the second death, right? Where the worm dies not. We can't do that, Dorothy, but we can do something like him. We're going to get to that, right? All right. Now, because of that sacrifice, just like that soldier who gives the ultimate sacrifice of his life in battle, what is the president supposed to do? Supposed to give him the Purple Heart or whatever. I don't focus on, I got a higher, I'm in a higher warfare right now. I'm in a higher military. We're in the Lord's army, the Salvation Army. Listen, Christ got a reward. Watch this, verse 9, Jesus. Wherefore God, because of his sacrificial life and death, God did something. Wherefore God, you see that next word? What's that next word?
Highly.
No. Before that.
Also.
Also. Oh. Don't miss that.
Oh, yeah.
Dear Sister Jan says, Ron, do a study of unto. See, even little words like that, which is you kind of pass, something like also, or what Krista said, even.
In addition to.
Yeah. Well, also. It's in response to what Jesus did. Wherefore, because of what Jesus did, God also did something to him, right?
Right.
Hey, son, you did this. Well, now I'm going to do this also. Wherefore, God also hath highly exalted him. I press toward that mark for the prize of the what? High calling of God. The next chapter, Paul said. Here we go. Highly exalted him. Speaking of Jesus. And given him a name which is above every name. Let me talk to you about this every
name. Above every name.
Above every name.
Yeah.
You don't have to go to the eighth definition of name to say. A name has to do, when we talk about names, they're more like some type of title, okay? God, he's called God. Well, that's a title. It's his name, the name of God. It's a title. It represents, it represents something. It represents who you are.
Can you say identify?
Oh, yeah, that's even better. It's an identity.
You know what my name means? Gift of God.
Dorothy, love that name.
Amen. You are a gift from God.
My father.
Well, I mean, in the Jewish culture, Hebrew culture, they name their children by faith. You know, right. Gift of God,
right.
Zachariah, you know, all the names.
Yeah.
We don't do that these days. It's just what sounds good or something. But that was the thing, and Muslims do it too. A lot of Muhammads and all this stuff. That's the most popular name or whatever. But after their prophet. Here's the point, their so-called prophet. Every name is name. It identifies you. And throughout his heavenly kingdom and the earthly kingdom, Paul says, not only in this world, but that which is coming. There's all type of ways to things that are going to be identified. Positions, okay? I'm a driver in my secular job, so forth, you know. Those things are going to represent, it's going to identify your place in that kingdom. For what the Lord Jesus Christ did, for his sacrifice, his name, his identity is the highest in all of creation. Jesus. Okay? His name is Jesus. And it was his human name, but you got to understand something. That's his name right now. When he met the Apostle Paul, what was his name before he became a man?
Paul.
Well, I'm sorry.
Wait, what are you talking about?
The Lord Jesus. Oh. He was the Word, right?
Right. You said before he met the Apostle Paul, what was his name?
I thought you meant
Paul.
Okay, so the Lord Jesus Christ is the Word, okay?
Right.
And in Revelation, calls him the Word because John, his futurist, talking about the Lord. Okay. But when he became a man, thou shalt call his name Jesus, so he saved his people from his sin. Jehovah's salvation is what it is, Joshua. Okay? Now, his name forever will be Jesus. When he came back to save Saul of Tarsus, he said, Saul, Saul, why persecutest thou me? He says, who art thou, Lord? Right? Who is the Lord? And what was his answer? I am
Jesus.
See, he's still in his humanity. That body that he has is human, humanity, it's humanity. It's just glorified humanity. Glorified humanity, okay? That's why he's still called Jesus. He's the Lord Jesus Christ. There's only one. Lord, righteous judge. Jesus, Jehovah's salvation, his name, Christ, the anointed Son of God. That's him. By the way, that's how you refer to him. The Lord Jesus Christ. That gives him his greatest honor. Dorothy, we were talking about how they're trying to take away, right? They take away from the Son of God. They take away from the faith of Jesus Christ. They take away Lord. They take away Paul's confession, Acts 9. The Ethiopian eunuch, Acts 8. They take away, I believe that Jesus is the Son of God. They take that out of the other version. To give him his due, the Lord Jesus Christ. And that's the name which is above every name. But there's all type of identifying names throughout the kingdom, all the way to the Lord. You ever hear him talk about the least and the greatest? The least and the greatest? So whatever identity, whatever position in that kingdom, he is the top dog of all. Verse number 10, that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow of things in heaven and things in earth and things under the earth, and that every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. Do it now, by the way. You should do it now. Now, it's going to happen in the future. You understand what Paul is saying? He's saying, you have to do that now. Because we're going to do it at the judgment seat. Israel and the nations are going to do it as return. everybody he's going to resurrect at the great white throne judgment is going to do it then. Both man and angelic beings. That every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father. And you know what that to the glory of God the Father? Look, the Father, that was, by the way, God the Father. Paul is telling believers, God the Father did this. Give him the glory and say, that was the righteous thing to do, Father. And Paul says, look, that's how he's going to deal with us. Just look at the next few verses. Wherefore? Say, go back to verse 9. Wherefore? Jesus did this. God the Father did this. You know what God the Father did? Wherefore? Now you do something. Oh, man. If people just study, I mean, my frustration is because you explain this stuff just right here. People, oh, we like Paul, and you know. Jesus did something. God the Father did something. Wherefore, now us, the body. What do you want us to do, Paul? Wherefore, my beloved? Paul had a wonderful relationship with the Philippians. Remember that, Acts 16, from Lydia. As ye have always what?
Obeyed.
Let me ask you, what are they obeying? Are they obeying the four Gospels?
No.
Are they obeying Hebrews to Revelation or the Old Testament law?
Yes.
No. The mystery. Everybody got that? This is in context of the mystery of Christ. Paul's doctrine, his teaching. You think Paul would say, hey, you obeyed, you follow the four Gospels. Man, he would be weeping and in sackcloth and ashes in his old Jewish persuasion, talking about, what are y'all doing? You did it with the Corinthians. Are you crazy? All right. Wherefore, my beloved, as you have always obeyed, not in my presence only, when he was there in Philippi in Acts 16. He wrote this probably about 10 years or so after that. But now, how much more? Oh, much more in my absence. Where was Paul when he wrote the book of Philippians?
Yeah.
He was at Rome, Caesar's palace. That's right. You can see that at the end. It says, verse 22 of chapter 4, all the saints salute you, chiefly they that are in Caesar's house, and so forth. Anyway. Point is, by the way, he's in bonds. Philippians 1:13, just people say, so that my bonds in Christ are manifest in all the palace and in all other places. Paul was in the Caesar's palace. He had gotten people in Caesar's own household saved while he was there. That's the apostle. You could chain him in a dungeon and people still get saved. And if he couldn't do it, he sent out a letter that was written by a guy, but Paul dictate and get it out. It's scripture. All right, we got to end. Here we go. Wherefore, my beloved, as ye have always obeyed, not as in my presence only, but now much more in my absence, work for your own salvation.
Yeah.
No.
Most churches, I could get away with doing that because they wouldn't be looking at the verses. I say work for. No, you don't work for your salvation.
Work out.
So you have salvation. Work it out with just chilling and resting in who you are in Christ.
No.
No. Because resting in who you are in Christ is a justification salvation issue. What Paul is talking about is to the beloved brethren who are saved is a walk, a sanctification. And how do you walk in sanctification? With fear and trembling to the word of the mystery. But Ron, if you teach that, that's just boasting in the flesh. That just works as the flesh. For it is, verse 13, calm down, everybody. Look at the next one. For when you work out your own salvation, when you have a mindset of fear and trembling, guess who's going to be working in you?
God.
For it is God which worketh in you, both to will, he's going to give you the word, and to do the ability of what?
His.
Good pleasure. So is it you doing it in the strength of your own flesh?
No.
It's you by faith in God's word with fear and trembling, allowing God to do it.
Amen.
Watch out for that false humility. Watch out for that thing.
By faith.
But it's God that's doing it. It's
faith.
The fruits of righteousness which are by Jesus Christ, Philippians 1. Right. You got to watch out with this little satanic, I'm just so humble and feel so
No.
Your humbleness comes from a mindset, but it comes from a mindset of I'm going to submit my heart. I'm going to submit my fear and trembling to the word of God through Paul. We're in a battle today in the last days.
Amen.
What we're going to see next week is what you were talking about, Dorothy, that issue of that walking in love as that sacrifice.
Yes.
That's Romans 12. I beseech you therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies as living sacrifices.
Right.
God don't want us blowing ourselves up and blowing up the infidels. He doesn't want that. That's what Satan wants. Satan wants you to blow yourself up and go to hell and everybody else with it. God wants you to get saved. God wants you to trust his son if you're lost. God wants you to get the life of the Lord Jesus Christ operating in you by faith. And if you're a believer today and you're saved, God has a plan to conform you right now to the image of his son. And it's only done with fear and trembling in the all of what the Apostle Paul has to say in his 13 books. Not just Romans, not just Corinthians, not just Galatians, not just Ephesians, not just Philippians, Colossians, 1st and 2nd Thessalonians, 1st and 2nd Timothy, Titus and Philemon. No. It's all of God's word through the Apostle Paul. Put together, reconciled in one. That takes study. That's a process. It takes humility. Having people teach you and learning from others. That's what the body does. That's what we do here. If you're listening today and you never had anyone love you enough to ask you, if you were to die today, do you know for sure where you spend eternity? We're talking about the love of God today. But God's love for you as a lost person starts with him giving you everlasting life, forgiveness of sins, keeping you out of hell and a lake of fire forever. You don't want to go there. It's hot down there. Torment. You don't have to go there. You're going to go there if you're lost, but you don't have to stay lost. You can get saved. How do you get saved? Romans chapter 5, verse 8. God sent the Apostle Paul with the gospel of grace. How that Christ died for his sins, was buried and rose again. God commended his love toward us, and that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. You don't have to do anything. No works are involved for salvation, to be right in the eyes of God for your sins. Just trust Jesus Christ, shed blood. God will save you this moment forever. Eternal life. Everlasting life. But he just doesn't want you to have everlasting life. He wants that to be life eternal. An eternal weight of glory with eternal glory. Well, that's what the rest of your life after salvation is all about. It's building the life of the Lord Jesus Christ. When Paul says to the Galatians in Galatians 4:19, he says, of whom I travail in birth again until Christ be formed in you. Hey, he had given them the doctrine. They left the doctrine. And they did what that Brad Pitt movie where the guy didn't grow up. He didn't go from young to old. He went from old to young. Benjamin Button or something. Mm-hmm. Every time I see that, I go, that was the Galatians. They had some maturity. The dude went from an old man, he got younger and younger to a younger Brad Pitt. Well, that was the Galatians. They were going backwards. Paul says, I got to do this again? Ladies, imagine having a baby. And then they said, let's start the process over. Put him right back in there. And here we go again.
Yeah, that's spiritual Benjamin Button disease.
There you go. It was a disease. A disease. Well, you don't have to do that. You can constantly grow and mature like the Lord Jesus who grew in wisdom and stature. We'll help you with that. That's what the grace of God is all about. The rightly divided word, particularly the mystery of Christ given to the Apostle Paul. Let's pray. Our gracious Heavenly Father, we do thank you for the Lord Jesus Christ and life in him. We thank you for that old rugged cross that we sang earlier. That emblem of suffering and shame. There's shame, there's suffering that the Lord endured, but he knew, as Hebrews says, the glory that shall be revealed later. The sufferings, then the glory. He saw the recompense of that reward, as it were. Oh, Father, let us have that same mindset. You don't call us to be death sacrifices, to die physically. You call us to live spiritually, to live in love and sacrifice, one toward another. Let us see the importance of obeying your word through the Apostle Paul and serving one another in the grace message. Galatians 5:13, only use not liberty for an occasion to the flesh, but by love serve one another. We thank you that all the law is fulfilled in that, loving your neighbor as yourself. May we walk in love one toward another, and obviously towards you by fear and trembling of your word, towards one another by allowing you to love our brethren through us as members of the body. We thank you for this time together as we have our Q&A. We give you thanks and praise in Christ's name. Amen.